So here in Brussels with the European Crowdsourcing Week, Joost, you gave your keynote today on stage. Can you share some more information of your background and also about the story you shared today with the audience?
Thanks, Martin. Well, my background is a legal and regulatory background, public policy. I used to work in telecommunications for a long time, when technology was merging with legal things and the other way around. And then afterwards I worked for the postal sector, which is the liberalization and privatization of the postal business. Also very much engaged in e-commerce and digital single market, these kind of things. So, and then afterwards I went to a European consultancy to do European lobbying, public affairs. And since November last year, I'm the director of public affairs of FEBIAC. And FEBIAC is the Belgian Association of the Automotive Sector.
Okay, and what was your key message today at the Crowdsourcing Week, and also what is the link between your business and crowdsourcing?
Right, well, the key message was that regulation and policy making is per definition always either too early or too late. So you can never match perfectly. It's what somebody said today, it's about facts and not about law. The law should follow the facts and not the other way around. And so that's one key message. The second is that automotive industry used to be seen as just hardware and not software on four wheels to put you from point A to point B. Whereas today we see a marriage between the ICT sector and the automotive sector, meaning that connectivity, autonomy, autonomous driving is more and more, well, it's very much relevant today. And so crowdsourcing is about getting ideas, getting, well, in the crowd, whatever you can source. And so a lot of things actually we can source as an industry in the cloud. And we're using Internet of Things and the cloud computing, big data, also for our business.
Yes. So there are lots going on. And also, I think also with the regulation. What do you think, when you look at Belgium, because I'm from the Netherlands, I know what's happening over there. And they got the same problems with the regulations. They are never too early, they're always too late. Yeah. But also the challenge is also they want to regulate it from day one.
Right.
And there are also quite some startups, especially also in the fintech industry, but also in the collaborative and sharing economy, say, okay, can't we think about a system where you say, okay, you are a startup, yes, we're going to give you borders, because else they're going to misbehave, of course, because they are also are smart entrepreneurs and marketers, and we'll give you space to experiment. We as a country, we are going to watch, we're going to learn, and based on the experience, we're going to make the regulations.
Right.
Are there things like that happening in Belgium? Or what is the way this things go?
I think it's a good question. It's good to compare the Netherlands with Belgium on that. I refer to the statement of Minister De Croo, Alexander De Croo, Vice Prime Minister, who said actually he wants to have a digital Belgium and a digital data. And he said these data that the government owns today and all the local authorities, they should not be the property of the government. They should be of the owner, which is actually the consumer, the guys who are running with Internet of Things, I would say. And so he wants to give back, or at least to open these data to a certain extent to the, for example, the SMEs. He says, and I believe that we are an SME country, full of SMEs. So, and these guys are great entrepreneurs, but they do not use the potential of the connectivity and the connected economy. We see it in our business, we see it in e-commerce. They're more dealing with how to build a website instead of just crowdsource the things that are already existing.
Yeah.
So, and that's the entrepreneurial part. What we see in terms of politics and in terms of regulation, we have at the federal level, we have a center-right government who promotes very much the initiatives like entrepreneurship, like SME take-up, and digital is very high on the agenda. Believing, and I think that's true, believing that it will triple the employment levels to some extent. In other parts of the country, like in Flanders, we have the same set of government constellations, so it's center-right. However, in Wallonia, we see a kind of different shift. They're also very much promoting economy, but have left-wing government with some central parties as well. So it's a different constellation, different mindset, but they do it on their own way. And so in our job in FEBIAC, we have to face at least five governments, three regional governments and then a federal one. And then even in Wallonia and Brussels, there is a joint government for cultural matters. I can tell you, if we talk about traffic safety, about ITS, intelligent transport systems, about big data, about with smart mobility, well, you have to face at least 5 ministers to get them across. Whereas in the Netherlands, if you compare it with the Netherlands, I think they are 10 years ahead of us in terms of forward-looking approach on smart mobility, on investments and infrastructure, actually using the money to directly invest into road infrastructure. And so we lost actually a lot of time there. And Brussels is not so smart as you could imagine.
And what do you think is the reason of this big difference? It's just
well, one of the reasons is that in the Netherlands is a central led economy and a central federal. We have a confederal system or a federal system, a bit like in Germany, but a bit more explicit in Belgium. Three regions with three sometimes different approaches, three different mission statements. They're not always synchronized for all good reasons. And so a lot of these things are not taken at a federal level, but at the local or at a regional level. And so while there is a transaction cost to the state reform, that's a political will and consensus, that's fine, but there's a cost to society of that, and we live in that actually today.
Yeah. And I think when you're going to look at the European level, there are even more stakeholders involved, and then it's for you need a job where you compare it to people who really want to have one European. So I think it's a really big challenge. And you was also talking about self-driving cars, but also the whole process, because when you say it started with cruise control, mm-hmm. and from then it's growing.
Right.
How long? I think discussion also about but when will we have the complete self-driving cars? Mm-hmm. Depends on who you're asking. Mm-hmm. I think when you ask it to a technical person or entrepreneur, the answer will be completely different than when you ask it to a lawyer. What do you think? What are the main challenges? There are many, I know, but what are the main challenges in the process of really getting this self-driving car accepted? Because the technique isn't a problem, because they will fix it, I guess. But I'm not the expert, of course.
I think it's a good question at a good timing. Well, people used to confuse a lot of things. So we're talking about connected cars, which is a car gives a signal that it captures to another car, and then does a lot of things with that in order to upgrade safety, security, and efficiency for the society. So that's one thing. And you see the levels of automation. It started with cruise control in the past. Already today, you can do a lot of things with connectivity and with technology. If you take a step further, which is then the autonomous driving or driverless cars, if you talk to engineers, they say more or less 10 years from now, we should be ready with all the algorithms on this, because it's not so easy. If you ride, for example, I think Volvo Cars has a test, live test going on in Gothenburg, so in Sweden, where they test live traffic with a self-driving car without anybody in it. It's called the Drive Me project. Toyota is testing things in Asia. So every brand is doing some. Mercedes is testing platooning, for example, for trucks, which is actually trucks or, I guess there is somebody in a truck, but he's not actually holding the steer. So, and that's reality. You can do that. And the UK, for example, also has a lot of trials going on. And Belgium will also be one of the trialing countries for some brands. So that's fine. But you need to have a lot of other things on the mind. For example, I think from a society perspective, it's about the people's mindset. If you ride in a car and next to you there is another car riding, or a truck with nobody in it, or guys sitting just like that and doing other things, or actually working, what you're not supposed to do when you steer the car. Well, you get a kind of mentality shift. That's first thing. The second thing, there are kind of the policymakers who are all usually later than the technology. They have to step in. It's a win-win here, and there you need some political decisions. One of them is an international convention. It's the United Nations, so a convention that sets the traffic rules, the basic traffic rules worldwide, which is fine. But actually, this convention dates from 1968, if I remember well, from Vienna Convention. And it says actually that you always have to be in the car and in front of, well, you always need to be in control of the traffic. That's Article 8.5, to be very
concrete. Or the illusion of having it, because in the end, you have control of your car, but the rest, you have right. no control at all.
But they were foreseeing and far seeing, because they talked about horses at the time and cars, and so driverless as such on the public domain would still not be allowed. However, there are amendments running from countries to at least to have trials to that. And what we do now with the Belgian government is there is a federal and a regional working group where we discuss the boundary conditions, which are, if you want to have a test on the motorway, for example, or more in other village traffic for a self-driving car, well, we think as a manufacturer and importer, we need to have security on the rules. Today it's a bit fluffy. Is it allowed or is it not allowed? What happens if there is an accident? So we need a roadmap, and that's actually what we're negotiating now with the governments. We call it a code of practice, where there are issues on infrastructure, what kind of infrastructure, where, who is monitoring what, what's going to happen with the data. Liability issues, data protection issues maybe as well. So all these things need first to be sorted out before we really have a car driving on itself.
So it will take some and because your organization got quite some members when you look at the members, is there because I guess there are quite some traditional members representing. Are there also already new members who haven't been in the automotive industry for let's say more than 2 years?
That's a good question. Actually, we are as an association, we are the importers and of the brands, and that's not only autos, cars, but also trucks and heavy duty and commercial vehicles, but also mopeds, for example, and electric bikes as well. So it's a whole scala, and it used to be the traditional brands. Now we have Tesla as a brand, and since some months now, we're also believing in the battery business, the mobile battery business as a vehicle to grid opportunity, and also as a local source for providing energy to your house and the other way around. So that's a new area. We have suppliers as well, some technical suppliers who have branches that are active in the automotive. But we not have the Ubers or the Movils from these days. They are not members yet, I would say.
Yeah, because I think maybe not now, but maybe let's say in 5 years or in 10 years, you're going to have some interesting situations where you're busy with developments that will hurt negatively a big part of your members.
That's one thing. Well, we see with the connectivity discussions. On the policy and also technical level, we see a kind of blurring in who invests in what kind of connectivity. In the past, it used to be the infrastructure owners who are supposed to invest in connectivity and in technology in order to give signals to the car owner or the guy who is riding the car that there is something going on, and so you better take attention to that. Today, the cars themselves get more and more smarter. It's a smartphone on four wheels and even more than that. And so they give signals to each other, and they can also pass on signals to third parties, provided there is all the kinds of data protection things that are regulated. So it's blurring, actually, who is doing what in our business. I referred in my presentation to HERE, so the Nokia digital maps business has been taken over by the three German brands on an arm's length basis, so they continue to put it at disposal for everybody. But it's an interesting move. We see in our business that ITS and ICT companies are actually moving in our targets, and we do the same thing there. So
So also it's not really clear. Also the future question of what is your market?
Exactly. Yeah. Right. Some brands believe, for example, the battery business is a market on itself. So some manufacturers and some importers we have to say, well, batteries, it's good as a fuel, as a source for the engine, for the powertrain. But actually, we do not need to own the battery. We can just lease it. And then the state of play is going much, much advanced in the latest years. So it's better to have that kind of model.
Yeah. And like today, when you hear stories about a car sharing platforms, a crowd delivery platforms, a parking space sharing platforms, in the end, when we have complete only self-driving cars, these platforms, they won't exist anymore because they are now a solution for a really inefficient system. But in the end, of course, we will never get maximum efficiency. I'm glad about that because that's also not a good thing. But in the end, their business will disappear when the cars are going to arrange it themselves.
I'm not Madame Soleil, I don't have the crystal ball here, and I believe you don't have neither. But what we see in terms of infrastructure investment, if I were a city, where should I invest in? Should I invest in to trying to optimize space and mobility with the current state of play, which is cars driving, buses, pedestrians? Or should I already take into account future steps in trying to solving a problem today? Wouldn't we be more prospective in the future and just adapt our cities and mobility issues to tomorrow? And tomorrow will probably be about electrification will be a big thing. We see that a lot of manufacturers are going in that way. It will be at more and more air quality issues due to transport, but also other things. We're not the only ones responsible for that. We heavily invested in upgrading our emissions in terms of healthy emissions instead of the bad ones. So that's a good investment for years now we do. However, some cities believe that they have to go to zero emission, like Amsterdam in 2025, I believe. So we need to adapt our business models as well. And that can be to alternative powertrains, alternative engines, or alternative mobility solutions, like the movers, like the Ubers of this world. Changing, it's a paradigm shift to some extent.
Yeah, that's right. And it's not only discussions about cars, because in the end,
it's car is just the instrument.
Transportation. It's all about the tram, the bus, the trucks, the bicycles.
See in terms of for technology, there is possibility today to have built in the car. If you wanted to go from point A to point B, and suppose you cannot have the car at point B for all kinds of reasons, that software already gives you the link to the bus or to public transport or even the Ubers. So there is a kind of interconnection between the several modes of transport. And that's something what the Netherlands have done much, much smarter than in our country, due to a more, a national reflex. Here we have a very regional and sometimes local, where the different transport system and transport modes, like individual car next to bus, tram, and others, are not really aligned. And so each time we try to reinvent the wheel and reinvent the water instead of, and that's exactly what we're trying to do at FEBIAC.
Yeah, and you said, you said, okay, platforms like Uber or also BlaBlaCar, they're not one of your members.
No.
Do you want them as your members? And then what value can they add for your organization, and what value can you add for them?
I think we have to see the DNA of FEBIAC is an association of the industry, and the industry being car importers and manufacturers at the end, I would say. And car and trucks and also motor, mopeds and so on. And so that's a product-driven approach, whereas the Ubers and all the other models is more a shared economy model, which is fine on itself, of course. It's innovation, it brings us forward. But maybe we have to rethink our DNA in some years from now, so I cannot make any official statements on that. But do we want to move to a mobility platform, a mobility association, and then why not everybody in that? But then, of course, you have you have all kinds of different interests.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure, as an association, you need to have very focused interests and in order not to have a least common denominator approach, which actually doesn't say a lot anymore.
Yeah,
to be relevant.
And it was also a tweet of Niels. the difference between FEBIAC and Nimber talk couldn't be bigger. It's a service or product that's your starting point. And I think that's all the difference.
Exactly.
Also the question, but in the end, the end consumer, they just want to have a solution.
Sure.
And they don't give anything about, okay, and what the way this solution will be realized.
I agree.
Okay, great. So thanks for the interview. I'm looking really forward what will happen with the industry, but also with your organization the next years. And thank you.
Well, I invite you to the European Automotive Forum, which we have in January next year.
Okay, great.
Connectivity.
Great, thank you.
You're welcome. Bye. Cheers.